bad there.
Well, good evening.
Hey.
We're front loaded this evening. I like it. And we're balanced in the back. This is good.
I'm making nervous.
Well, I don't get nervous. Praise the Lord. Hey, now. But the first time. Never mind. So let's start from another day. See, what makes me nervous is the camera monitor right there that shows my big old mug that's on the TV in the town I'm in. That makes me nervous. So tonight. Anybody need to hear about the presence of God in calamity? Anybody ever had some calamity? Anybody ever had some trials or some tribulation or some stuff? We'll just call it stuff.
What's that?
Calamity? Stuff? What's that? I don't even know. God is our refuge and our strength, mighty and impenetrable to temptation. A very present and well-proved help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change and though the mountains be shaken into the midst of the seas, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swell and tumult, whatever that word is, Salah, pause and calmly think of that. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God and the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her right early at the dawn of the morning. The nations raged. The kingdoms tottered and were moved. He uttered his voice and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, our fortress, and our high tower. Pause and think and calmly think of that. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who has wrought desolation and wonders in the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow into pieces and snaps the spear in two. He burns the chariots in the fire. Let be and be still and know, recognize and understand that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, our high tower and our stronghold. Pause and calmly think of that. And a lot of people have been posting their favorite scriptures on Facebook, and a lot of people have chosen Psalm 46:10, which in the King James says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth." And a very good friend of mine says that she does this exercise, right? So, be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know that I. Be still and know. Be still. Be. Sometimes the most difficult challenge is for us to just stop. Just stop. And find that peace. We have to hold our peace. We have to protect our peace. We have to seek refuge. And he is our refuge. He will never fail us. He will never, ever leave us or forsake us. And he will not leave us without a covering, without a safe refuge, without safe harbor. There is nothing that this world has to come against us that can defeat him. It's him. It's his battle. It all belongs to him. And when we trust and when we rest, and we hold that peace that he has given us by the very Spirit, the God of peace, the Prince of Peace abides in us. But we give away our peace. We just hand it over and get caught in the winds blowing to and fro. Oh, those winds can blow. They can tear down a house. They can throw a tree. They can move those mountains into the sea. But they cannot hurt you. We cannot be shaken. All we have to do is stand. Just stand. And just call on him, and he is faithful. But the most challenging part is to be still. To be still. To just be. Amen. 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 That'll preach, I do believe. Good word. It's all good news. Anybody else have any prayer requests or anything else they'd like to share tonight? Anybody? Yeah, Roberto.
Just prayer for my
You're going to go see your dad for the first time in 3 years. Is this in the hospital with the whole Alzheimer's thing? And for my sisters, but they also have revelation. My oldest sister, she, every time that I hear John chapter 8, I think it's John chapter 8, and Jesus tells the people, my word has no place in you. It's kind of sad that it reminds me of her, because she says so many things, but it's like, it doesn't matter what you can say about what's in the scripture, if you don't let it operate on you, you're not going to change. So for her to have that revelation, she starts actually speaking good things instead of saying, oh, I'm poor. Well, you're going to continue to be poor if you keep saying that you're poor, you know? I told her that and she got mad at me. But yeah, that and for my wife.
Yeah, here the guy, I don't know, he's like 55, Mike, older guy, unknown guy working with me on the customer, and he's got some sort of cancer, and he's real weak, and he's in the hospital, and I hope that he understands who Jesus is, and I hope that he gets lifted up tonight, because I think that that's rough, going through that stuff, not thinking he has a real life to live, and it's really like, horrifying to have his family there, and not realizing what's going on, and he kind of knows, but we know who knows, and hopefully he has protection. So, and me for recuperating on this finger and the anxiety I have, and to be a little bit more selective where I carry stuff, like I left my check and stuff, and to be a little bit more careful and courageous, and just be opened up to where I can find stuff and be to reveal
Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Yeah, continue to pray for my wife. She's struggling right now, and I know that's just in the flesh and in the spirit. It's hard to take care of, but here in a few minutes, I want to have us pray for John, but I want to read this scripture. It's out of Colossians, and it says, and I am proclaiming this, prophesying, this is the word of God. And this is over each and every one of us, but I have I just want this to hopefully, not hopefully because it will, because I'm saying it will, but for my wife, for John, for all of us. But it says, you don't need a telescope, a microscope, or a horoscope to realize the fullness of Christ and the emptiness of this universe without Him. When you come to Him, that fullness comes together for you. His power extends over everything. Entering into this fullness is not something you figure out or achieve. It's not a matter of being circumcised or keeping a long list of laws. No, you're already in. You are insiders, not through some secretive initiation rite, but rather through that, through what Christ has already gone through for you, destroying the power of sin. That's the word of God.
Yeah, right.
And I'm boom, it's there. In
yes.
Jesus' name.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen.
All right. Anybody else? Did you have anything to share?
Ron called and his backs went out on him, so he asked for prayer tonight and then he'll make it on Sunday. My sister in law Rose, radiation, and I was at a house yesterday with one of my elderly clients, and he was in remission from cancer, and now it's back again, so we'll pray for him. He's not going to do anything, just let Mother Nature take its course, he said, whatever happens.
Yeah.
He's 88, but, you know, he just doesn't want to be in pain, or we just want to just have the Lord take him.
Okay.
Robert said she was back in the hospital, left a message at the house. Details unknown, just pray for God to just be on them,
yeah.
Watch over them, and just stay in intercession. We got a camper at the house, the pickup camper. I gotta get it sold, so So I'm just praying the Lord will provide someone to get it out of my hair. That's stopping a lot of progression of other things. It's kind of like a clogged drain. I got to get it out of there. The sink is full.
Amen.
Thank you. Court your bride. Dance with your bride, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Glory to your name, Lord. Glory to your name, Lord. Glory, 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 glory,
Lord. We love you tonight, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our needs. Hallelujah, from your riches of glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for that hope of glory. Christ in me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for meeting every need, for being the source to supply every situation, every circumstance, every individual. We bless you for it. We bless you for your fullness, Lord, the completeness of Christ in us that satisfies every need. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
The river, the water that quenches our soul. Hallelujah. The water that floods our spirit and overflows. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you again, worship team. Hallelujah. God is good. Amazing. Hallelujah. He doesn't need thousands. He doesn't even need tens. Praise the Lord. He just needs two. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And if you're ever short one, he's the second. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I want to start with John chapter 14 and verse 27. Just one verse of scripture here, and then we'll go to Isaiah chapter 6. But beginning here in John 14 and 27. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Isaiah 6 what?
Pardon?
Isaiah 6 what?
6, 1 through 9.
Okay.
Praise God. Okay, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I was thinking while I was worshiping here this evening, you know, how a lot of times when you're worshiping like this and the just random thoughts come to your mind, it doesn't make you an evil person or a bad person. It just means we don't have a whole lot of control over our thoughts. Not very well disciplined. But stuff does come. And I know for me personally, anyway, when it does, I just forget about it. I'm praying in tongues or worshiping the Lord, and I don't dwell on it. I just let it move right on through and keep going. And I thought, you know, the Lord was speaking to me that it's the same way when you have symptoms, whatever they might be, whether it's symptoms for a virus, you know, some other situation or circumstance, or whether it's the symptoms of your finances, you know, bank accounts declaring one thing, God declaring another, whether it's, you know, symptoms for relationships, you're claiming that everything is made whole and everything is dysfunctional on another level, praise the Lord. But what we have to do is just let those thoughts pass on through and focus on what God has said. It's okay to have the thoughts. I mean, it doesn't make you bad, doesn't make you a failure because you think those things. It just, you know, you just have to let them be what they are. They're transient. They're not permanent. You know, they're not eternal. They're just momentary, temporary feelings and thoughts that are passing through. Amen. But the Word of God is settled forever. It's sure, whether it's about any of these things. And that's the thing that we always have to come back to. But this is what he says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives. So it's not based on, you know, the peace that God gives us isn't based on material or tangible evidence. It's based on his promise, on his presence. Amen. So he gives us peace, but that peace is something we have to focus on. We have to make ourselves aware of. Amen. It's not the kind of peace that the world gives. You can have the world, the kind of peace the world gives you is when everything is going good, you can relax. But you can't really relax because you know things are going too good. There has to be something bad coming. Right? Praise the Lord. So, but that's what he's saying. The peace I give you isn't like, it isn't based on the things that the world gives you peace through. So you can be in the middle of a storm and still have peace. That's the peace that he gives us. Amen. With his presence. I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. No matter what it is, no matter what the circumstance, don't let your heart be troubled. Don't be afraid. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm afraid you made a poor choice. Don't be afraid. Don't let your heart be troubled. He'll make all things work together for good to them that love God. You say, well, you can't just be irrational. Sure you can. If you're not, you're not really a Christian. I mean, irrational in terms of how the world looks at things.
Right?
Praise the Lord. Okay, Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 9. Suzanne just sang this. Well, the worship team just sang it. Second song that you did. Actually, it was Roberto, I guess. But you guys were standing so close together. Front row, it's hard to tell.
You look so much alike.
Yeah, you're both. You don't have that kind of Latin look, so. A little Latin loop-de-loop over here, praise the Lord. I'm on medication, so. Yeah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Praise the Lord. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, Lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. This is as close to a Jesus encounter as you were ever going to get in the old covenant. Praise the Lord. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, Here am I, send me. And he said, Go, and tell this people, Hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but perceive not. Praise the Lord. So the world, if you go all the way back, you can see throughout Scripture, the world was made, the purpose for God creating the earth was for his glory to be revealed. Amen? But his glory in creation was made manifest in a man and a woman. Praise the Lord. Are you with me? Hallelujah. He everything God did is to reveal his glory. And the way he did it in the initial creation was he revealed that glory through Adam and Eve. Yeah. Uh-huh. Praise the Lord. So they were, because they were bearers of his image. Yeah. Right? They were created to take dominion over creation. When sin entered us, mankind, it entered the world. Amen. The only way it could get into the world was through us. The obverse of that is the only way that the glory of God gets into this world is through us. That's how it's revealed. Praise the Lord. So, Romans chapter 3, verses 21 and 22. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. So when righteousness entered us, it entered the world.
Right.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That's why a whole gospel has to be explicitly about restoration. About the restoration of God's image bearers. Amen. And also about the restoration of the entire manifestation of glory. That's the premise. You know, I mean, that's the basis. That's why the gospel, that's why this is so important. It isn't a pass. I mean, it isn't like we're just trying to get a free pass here. This is the plan and the purpose of God.
Yep.
Praise God. It is central. If it isn't preached, then we're preaching nothing. We're preaching religion, which has absolutely nothing to do with the glory of God. Praise God. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith in Jesus Christ, and unto all and upon all them that believe, for there's no difference. This is the glory coming in. This is the way for God to reveal his glory, and it has to be on men. And the only way it can happen on men is for man to be in a state of innocence.
Right.
Praise the Lord. The original condition, which is why we had to be redeemed. Amen. So the whole gospel has to be not just, you know, kind of about or partly about, but it has to be explicitly about the restoration of God's image bearers.
Amen.
If they were the ones that revealed the glory of God, then this thing is about the image bearers again so that God can be revealed. Praise God. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, let's go back to Isaiah chapter 6. This time let's read from verse 6 through 13. And I'm just making some little analogies here between some of these scriptures as we move along, but hopefully you can see that. But the great point here is that's what this whole story is about here in the first 9 verses, actually the whole 6th chapter of Isaiah. It's a metaphor, if you will, for Jesus, for the coming of the Lord.
What?
For the glory of God to be again revealed in people. He says he put the coal to it and his iniquity was removed, his sins were no more, right? Glory, glory, glory. Holy, 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 right? So then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. And he said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not. See ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat. Make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert, and be healed. Then said I, Lord, how long? And he answered, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land be utterly desolate, and the Lord have removed men far away, and there be a great forsaking in the midst of the land. But yet in it shall be a tenth, and it shall return, and shall be eaten, as a tail tree, as an oak, whose substance is in them. When they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the substance thereof. Now, this is talking about, again, the glory of God being revealed. He says, do this until man is no longer in charge of this, or until man no longer can feel like he is doing things. He's the one that's doing it. Get it to the end of himself. Keep telling them, keep preaching it, and until they just are finished. And then I'll have a remnant. I'll have somebody there. And it'll be a tent. And that's the tithe. Praise the Lord. And how many know that by the tithe, the whole is made holy? Praise the Lord. And yet shall be a tenth, and it shall return and shall be eaten as a teal tree, as an oak with whose substance is in them. Praise the Lord. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Amen. And whose substance is in them. And when they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the substance thereof. The fruit. Amen. We abide in him, and the fruit comes automatically. Praise the Lord. The substance of that fruit is the holiness of God. It's the revelation of God. Praise God. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's look at Acts chapter 28, verses 23 through 31. I'm not trying to be complex here, but I'm just saying this is all about God being revealed through humanity. God's glory being revealed through the church. Praise the Lord. Acts 28, 23 through 31. And when they had appointed him a day, there came many to him into his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets, from morning till evening. Some believed the things which were spoken, and some believed not. And when they agreed not among themselves, they departed after that Paul had spoken one word. Well spake the Holy Ghost by Isaiah the prophet unto our fathers, saying, go unto this people and say, hearing ye shall hear and shall not understand. Seeing ye shall see and not perceive. For the heart of this people is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes, and their eyes have they closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them. Be it known therefore unto you that the salvation of God is sent unto the Gentiles, that they will hear it. Praise the Lord. So, in this context, who gets the message of grace? Well, everybody gets it, but I mean, everybody is offered it, but you know, most significantly, it's the Gentiles who receive it. Praise the Lord. So it's this weaving together of God and humans and all of creation. And that's the kingdom. This is the kingdom. Romans 4, verse 17. The kingdom is not meat or drink. It's not here nor there. But it's righteousness and peace in the Holy Ghost. In you, Christ in you. Amen. Romans 14, verse 17.
14.
Mm-hmm. Romans 14 and 17. As it is written, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. Kingdom of God, not meat, not drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. So here's this uniting or fulfilling justice, satisfying the just demands of God, and the result is joy and delight, peace, joy in the Holy Spirit. Amen? It's what the Hebrew prophets call shalom. It isn't just peace, you know, I mean, it's not just absence of war or a stalemate or a compromise. It's wholeness. It's everything. It's all that you need to be satisfied. That's the peace. That's the real peace. Amen. Romans 3, verse 20 and 21. The Prince of Peace. Peace I give you. Not peace like the world gives you, but my peace I give unto you, right? Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified. Now, we just read that we were justified, or that the justice is satisfied, amen, in this reuniting of God and man and revelation then of the glory of God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there is no flesh shall be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, amen. So Jesus, again, is the Prince of Peace. He's the one who brought peace to the earth. He brought peace between God and man. Amen? We call it peace, but it means a whole lot more than that. Praise God. In the Bible, shalom means universal flourishing, wholeness, and delight. If we were to flash back to the scriptures we read a few moments ago, how this... the branches put out leaves and they fall, amen, and produce, you know, a multiplication, if you will, that plant, or in this case, the metaphor for God. Praise the Lord. So, shalom, in other words, is the way things ought to be. Praise the Lord. I mean, from a biblical perspective, from God's point of view, shalom is the way things ought to be. Praise the Lord. The order is the order that God established when he created the universe and us, its inhabitants. Praise the Lord. And it is actually, it's reflected in the law, because it shows, you know, the righteousness of God, the perfection of God, the holiness of God. And it's summarized in these in the commands to the first humans on the planet, amen, which was not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Praise God. But it's bigger than just legal commands. It's a system of order. It's the state of things. Praise God. Shalom is the word for when the state of things is in harmony with God's holiness. That's why the pillars shook. There was a vibration. Because for a moment, things were in order. There was shalom. Even though it didn't look like shalom to the casual observer, the reality was everything was vibrating at the same man, this particular man, God, the angels, and the atmosphere around. Praise the Lord. We sometimes feel it. We call it the anointing, the goosebumps, whatever you want to call it. But the truth is, things, because you're so aware of God and his presence, God becomes more real in that sense. And there's a resonating, amen, between you and God, a vibration, if you will, that is shalom. It's things are in order. And you feel it. You feel at peace, do you not? When you're worshiping, you can come in here and have all kinds of crap going on, whether it's in your body or in your, you know, personal life, on your job, finance, whatever it is. But if you can get into that place of shalom, amen, there is a vibration, whatever. It's you're in sync with God. And the result of that is peace. The result for you is peace. The result for God is glory. His glory is revealed. People are going, oh, God is here. God is moving. And in that same atmosphere, God heals. God delivers. God supplies. Amen? Because we know he's here, we believe. And wherever God is, miracles happen. It isn't that he's not here all the time. It's just that it isn't always, his always being here, amen, isn't always acknowledged by us to a degree that there is a harmony between us and our Creator. And that's why grace is so radically important, because without grace, there can be no awareness of this harmony, of this oneness. That's how God is glorified. That's why it has to be by grace. That's why the law actually testifies to this. Because there was, man could not get close to God. There could not be harmony. There could not be this shalom, amen, as long as there was something separating us from God, because we couldn't have that oneness with God. God was as, I don't want to say frustrated, but it was as much against God's purposes as it was against man's. Praise the Lord. Until there was a knowledge of good and evil, I'm, you know, going back to what I was saying before about the law, in case I was vague or confusing. But until there was that knowledge of good and evil, there was no separation.
Right.
There was harmony. There was shalom. The earth was filled with the glory of God.
Glory.
There was a resonating awareness and connection with God that caused these people to be totally at peace.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Praise the Lord. That's God's plan. That's God's purpose for this earth. You can say, well, the kingdom of God then was the garden. But the truth is, the kingdom of God was just wherever these people were. They happened to be in the garden.
Right.
The kingdom of God was in them. It was God's connection with them. They're bearing the image of God. They're being in sync with what God's plan and purpose was.
Now, believe me, it wasn't a hard thing for them to do that. They just got up every morning and went about their business in harmony with God.
Yes.
That's what God wants for us. That's the idea of the no consciousness of sin. Because then we can walk in this constant vibration. Sally was chilling in the garden the other day, and she said, "My hands just vibrate." You ever done anything like that? You know, you guys ever run a jackhammer or anything, or a hammer drill, or tiller, some lawnmowers even, and you just after about half hour, when you're done, you're still vibrating. You can just feel it, almost like your hands are asleep or something, tingling, you know, goes through you. That's because you become one with that machine, praise the Lord, for a little while. I mean, you're just there so long that it just kind of carries over. And that's a poor metaphor, but a metaphor for what we're doing with God. We get into sync with the rhythm of God, and we begin to vibrate at that same speed or that same level. And then when we go about our mundane kind of affairs, it's still there.
Come on.
We're still aware of His presence. Mm-hmm. There's a continuation of that. And the other thing is, other people see the vibration. Praise the Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
Other people are affected by that, you know. So, hallelujah. That's what we're talking about. This is about the things in life. Us, our situations and our circumstances, our finances, our physical health, our relationships and all that stuff, being in harmony with God's holiness. That's God's plan. That's God's intent for us. Amen? So again, let's go back to Romans chapter 14, verse 17. Hallelujah. Kingdom of God is not meat, not drink. It's not the stuff. It's the righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The stuff gets added as a result of the righteousness, peace, and joy. In other words, the stuff comes because you're vibrating at the same vibration of God. There's a transfer that can take place. I hope I'm not being too squirrely here, but you know what I'm saying? When you're in tune with God, everything that God has flows. It just flows back and forth. Yeah. It's like Jacob's ladder. It's a connection. So the things of God are freely given. But only if you're in the Spirit. So the kingdom of God isn't meat and drink, but it does supply the meat and drink. It does supply the tangibles that we have need of. But it doesn't come as a result of going after the things. It comes as a result of being in harmony with God's holiness by righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Not in you, not in your abilities, but in what God has done for you, resting in the finished work of the cross, in other words. Amen? So the result of that order here is kingdom manifestation. And kingdom manifestation is simply wherever there is lack, the lack is met. The need is filled. There is no lack in the kingdom, in other words. So whenever we're actually operating in the kingdom of God, darkness flees, light is, and wherever that light is the presence of God, and wherever the presence of God is, there is fullness of joy. There is shalom. There's flourishing in every area.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So the answer to all of this, or at least the one way of looking at it, is nothing satisfies us but shalom itself. That's why religion never can get it. I mean, it never can do it. It can entertain you to some degree. It can certainly put you under condemnation and guilt. But that isn't what we're crying out for. That isn't what the Spirit is longing for. The Spirit's longing for shalom, which is that harmony with God, that oneness with God.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Okay, back to Isaiah chapter 6 and verses 9 through 12 this time. Isaiah 6, 9 through 12. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Lord. And he said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not. See ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert, and be healed. Then said I, Lord, how long? And he answered, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land be utterly desolate, and the Lord have removed men far away, and there be a great forsaking in the midst of the land. So, I just kind of grazed over this, but saying it's man has got to come to the end of himself. He can quit. He has to quit depending on the houses, the land, the cities. You don't understand what I'm saying? What he can produce, what he can, you know, get, amen, and come to the total end of himself. But here's what's ironic about it. Actually, it's illogical, but we look to institutions, and we look to philosophies, and we look to religions and theologies for the answer that he's telling us, I'm going to have to waste all of that before I can get you to where I want you to be, to where you can hear. Because as long as you're there, your ears are heavy, your eyes are veiled, right? You're not going to get it. You're not going to ever get this shalom, this harmony with God, this resonating with God's peace coming back and forth to us, his holiness being revealed, his glory being revealed, through religion, through mental assent, through more teaching, per se, academically or intellectually. You know what I'm saying? This is revelation. Praise God. So it's just counterintuitive. It's illogical, and yet it's exactly what we always end up doing. Going back to religion. Going back to some philosophy, which is all man-based.
Right.
So there's no answer there. There's no shalom there, because there's no connection with God there.
Right.
There's no flourishing. Amen? There's a superficial kind of look to it, but there's no depth because there's no connection to the vine.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So, you know, foolishly, what we do is we end up looking to people for fixes. We look to broken ideas in broken places from broken people,
right,
thinking that that's going to fix us. If that were the case, we wouldn't have the chaos in the world today. The reason we have it is because we're still looking for man. I mean, that's the UN, that's NATO, that's governments, that's all this. Looking to them thinking they got the answer. They do not have the answer. League of Nations didn't have, they thought it had the answer after World War I. Until World War II came along and they found out it was totally inept.
Right.
We see the same thing with the United Nations. Anybody with half a brain looks at it and goes, these people are good for nothing except delivering food once in a while, and they usually screw that up. But they want you to believe they're the great peacekeepers. I haven't seen them do it anywhere. I've seen them get shot standing around with their blue helmets. You know, like, I'm a peacekeeper. Okay, we don't want peace. Pop.
Right.
It doesn't work. Praise the Lord. Self-effort, self-worth for justification. Amen. Mm-hmm. When shalom is what we're really looking for.
Yes.
We're not looking for just an absence of war, because as soon as this one ends, there'll be another one pop up.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking for a reconnect. We're looking for God's flourishing. We're looking for God's appearing. We're looking for God's original plan, and nothing else is going to satisfy us. Okay, Romans 8, verses 1 through 4. Now, I want you to see that I've kind of talked about this a little bit Sunday, but let's see it again, because it goes back to what he's talking about there in Isaiah, men coming to the end of themselves. No longer about philosophies and religion and man's abilities and so on and so forth. But there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. Okay, so we know that sounds like peace. Right? For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. Okay? Verses 3 and 4. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Now, here's what you got to see. The righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, not by us, in us.
Amen.
We didn't do it.
Right.
The righteousness of the law is fulfilled in us.
Come on.
Not by us. It's the glory that goes to God. Yeah. Because we didn't do it. He did it.
That's right.
That's why I got to wait till they wore themselves out with their own doings and their own wisdom and their own understanding until they finally come to the place where they realize God does this. And when that happens, when I really begin to realize that, God's righteousness, God's holiness, God's everything that God is revealed not by me, but in me.
Yes.
Without me doing anything, with me just being connected to God, all of a sudden his glory begins to fill the earth again. Wherever a believer is that's in that in sync with God,
thank you, Jesus.
We're back to the original plan.
Thank you, Jesus.
Everything's in harmony again.
Hallelujah.
With holiness. You understand? Because it's not my holiness. It's his holiness.
Amen.
I'm still screwing up. I'm still making mistakes. But I quit looking to me for holiness. I quit looking to me, amen, to fulfill his righteousness. I quit looking to me to be the thing that fulfills him or that satisfies the need for righteousness in me. I look to him, and it comes out of me. It comes as a result of him in me. Not what I'm doing, what he's already done.
Amen.
Amen? More people, you know, give up on church, give up on God, give up on it, because they continue to look at themselves.
Yep.
Now, I'm not picking on people for that, because I've done, that's the way it is. I said Sunday, I don't even know how to define a Christian. Be honest with you, other than just somebody who agrees with God, even about yourself. Now that's looking at things that are not as though they are. You're looking at a physical thing that is a failing, that is a disconnect from everything we understand about God. But he says, in me is the hope of glory. In me.
Yes.
Is God's hope for this connection, for this unity, for this oneness, for his original intent to be in this earth again.
Amen.
To get the plan back on track.
Amen.
To get the glory of God to fill the earth.
Glory.
And it only happens, just based on Isaiah 6, it only happens when I get through with me.
There you go.
When I stop trying to produce it, then God will cause me to flourish like this oak tree that just drops its leaves and reproduces and reproduces. I'm not reproducing anything. I'm not saving people. I'm just flourishing in Christ. And the result of my flourishing is all of these other people start coming to Jesus.
Come on, man.
All these other people start to be born again. Seed is out there simply because of my being connected to God.
Hallelujah.
Amen?
Amen.
So the law is fulfilled in us, not by us.
Right.
Because the kingdom of God is in you. Not on you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So kingdom peace can't be manifest by religion.
That's right.
That is self-righteousness. That's will worship. That's what the Bible calls will worship.
Mm-hmm.
Worshiping your own self-will, your own determination, your own self-effort.
Yep.
Amen. No matter how many people, it helps. And it does help some people. In practical ways. No matter how good it makes you feel. Because you can feel good about doing good stuff. The problem is you're going to feel bad when you're doing bad stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But all of that is religious effort. And it's meaningless. Peace only comes, shalom only comes by the presence of God. Not by how much good you're doing. Not about how faithful you are to the rules and the regulations of the local church.
Right.
See, the irony of religious legalist approach to shalom is that God is the author of every good thing. Mm-hmm. Half the stuff you're doing that you feel guilty about, God created. And you're feeling bad because religion has made it evil. God didn't make it evil. God created it in the first place.
Right.
Pleasure. There's a big, big bad thing. Partying. Let me just get right in your nest with you and mess you up, praise the Lord. Gardens. Sally, say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Work. Work! Money. Amen. Material things. The big S. Sex. All the guys said, praise the Lord.
Lord.
Hallelujah. All of them were God's ideas. All of them. I'm feeling more spiritual all the time. Hallelujah. Praise the
Lord.
Thank you. Praise God. I got a witness here. Adam and Eve were created. They were set in the garden with all of their needs provided for. Now that's a good deal. I love how God starts this out. One man, one woman, a bunch of acreage, and naked.
Yeah.
Doesn't get any better than that.
Awesome.
Praise God. And God says, go play. Have a good time. This is what shalom looked like. Praise the Lord. Religion gives the idea that God is some kind of cosmic killjoy. And the fact is, he's just the opposite. All of this stuff he created. And he didn't create it for him, he created it for us. So he's not this cosmic killjoy, because I'm standing on Scripture when I say that this longing in the core of who we are, that cries like Isaiah for acceptance, for forgiveness, for purpose, for happiness, for delight, was put there by God. And he makes us that way.
Yeah.
And he means to satisfy us.
Yeah.
The ache is bigger than all of us. So we need a redemption that's bigger than all of us.
Jesus.
That's why none of us are going to be able to produce it. Not even all of us could produce it.
Right.
Okay, back to Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 10. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert and be healed. Now that's Old Covenant, but look at Luke chapter 19, verses 41 and 42. Luke 19, 41 and 42. And this is Jesus, speaking of Jesus here, and it says, when he was come near, he beheld the city and wept over it. Now remember, this is still Old Testament as well.
Right.
It's in the Gospels, but it's still under the Old Covenant. And he says, saying, if thou hadst known, even thou at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes. What? What was he talking about? Him, the Messiah. Grace and truth came by Jesus. And yet, they still couldn't see it.
Right.
Even though it was right there in front of them.
Right.
All right, Romans 5, verses 1 and 2. And we'll wrap up here. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith unto this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God.
Hallelujah.
It can't get much simpler than that. Amen? Mm-hmm. So that's bigger than us.
Right.
It's God big. Amen? Because it's Shalom.
Yes. Right.
Praise God. All right? Isaiah 6, 1 through 3. And here you've got what it was from the fall of Adam and Eve. This is like since Adam and Eve, here you got somebody who's come into the presence of God. And it's like God showing us what that original Shalom was. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting on the throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. And above us stood the seraphims, each one had six wings. Twain he covered his face, twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory. Now that is taking us back to the original condition before the fall of man.
Yes.
And then how, I won't, you don't have to go there right now, but so then God actually even shows us then how that manifests.
Yes. Yes.
Whoa. Is me. I'm a screw up and I can't fix it.
Mm-hmm.
So God comes,
Lord,
and purges him and says, your iniquities are gone, your sins are remembered no more. And the immediate thing he responds is then, okay, what can I do to reveal your glory? I'm paraphrasing or kind of putting my own words in there, but that's actually what he's saying. How can I now get you back into this world? And he said, go. Just go. That's all you got to do. Just go. I'll do the rest. It may look like you're doing nothing. Because there are those who are, eyes are heavy, ears are closed, what I'm talking, religious, legalists. But don't let that bother you. Because there's some that will. And that some that will reproduce more than the original whole. And they'll influence them as well. Because it'll be me doing it, not you. It'll be just you reconnecting with me, and the result of that will be Shalom. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay? So, he's showing us, in those first three verses, he's showing us the Shalom void, basically. This absence. Okay? Alright, Colossians chapter 1. Verses 26 and 27. This will be the last scripture. Even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints. Now, he's talking about what was with Adam and Eve, but hasn't been. It's been nothing but a mystery since. Hidden. From ages and from generations, but now it's made manifest to his saints. It was hidden because their eyes were dim, their ears were heavy, blah, 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 blah. Okay? To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of his mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. So, finally, something, someone big enough to fill the void.
Yes.
Shalom in you, the hope of glory. To fill the earth. Hallelujah. That's what all that scripture is talking about when he says, peace I give you, peace. The Prince of Peace comes. Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Right. Yeah.
Finally, something big enough to fill that void and connect you again with God so that his glory can fill the earth.
Yes.
Amen? Yeah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Amen. And he did it all.
Because he's the only one who could. And all he asked of us is to acknowledge that. And that alone. Praise the Lord. And the result is I'm picking up good vibrations. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Keep that in mind. As you go through the rest of this week, just stay connected. Just stay aware. Just realize he's doing it all. Amen?
Amen.
All you got to do is carry the vibes. Drop the leaves. Amen? Be happy. Don't worry. Praise the Lord. Don't worry.
Yeah.
All right, guys.
Thank you, Freddie.